Hi, my name is Zach, and today I'm going to be reviewing the hotly requested Mikael Akerfeldt of Opeth. You guys have asked me about this since I started making these videos. Well, here he is. Now, I'm sorry to disappoint some of you, but I am not going to be reviewing his harsh vocals. I'm going to be taking something that's a little softer of his. I'm actually going to be reviewing his Death Whispered a Lullaby from Live at Shepherd's Bush Empire performance. I feel like this did a pretty good job of combining some of his strengths and his weaknesses, and it kept the harsh vocal stuff out of it. In case you've never watched my videos before, this is an academic objective analysis. If I didn't like him as a singer, I probably wouldn't be reviewing him on my own, but I'm not going to turn this into a fanboy escapade where I just say that he could do no wrong. I look at this as if he came into my voice studio and were one of my voice students. So if I say something that is a critique of him, it's nothing that I wouldn't critique myself on or something that I wouldn't critique any voice student. So without further ado, here we go. Let's get started.
Out on the road, there are fireflies circling.
So if you've ever watched any of my videos before, you can probably guess that I'm going to have a few things to say about this already. He started out with a glottal onset, which I've talked about before, is where you have a lot of pressure built up under the vocal folds, and you have a kind of a popping motion that happens as a result of the folds pushing together when they go to vibrate with the result of the pressure underneath it. And that happens the most when you have a word with a vowel at the beginning of it, and it's literally the very first thing that comes out of his mouth here. He's also singing with a covered sound, which means he's putting air over the... He's doing that kind of thing as opposed to da 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 dum. So it could be an artistic choice here. When your vocal folds aren't fully closed, which is a byproduct of that really aspirate, breathy, covered singing, it tends to just make things more difficult, and it also causes injury in the long run. Like if you do that a lot, the folds will be like vibrating against each other in a way that they don't naturally do. And you see things like vocal nodules, like one of the biggest examples I tend to use of cover singing is John Mayer. He's had vocal nodules. I know at least once, maybe twice, I'm not sure, but it's because of the way that he sings. Using the covered sound with a lot of air over the top of it is a major health hazard to your vocal folds. So let's continue.
Deep in the wood, where the lost soul hide. Over the hill, there are men returning.
So that, in case anyone was wondering, was an example of him moving into his falsetto. As I mentioned in videos before, there's a lot of confusion about head voice and falsetto, which is which. In this case, for all intents and purposes, he goes from his chest voice or his modal register into his falsetto on that line. So there, he doesn't really use what we'd call a mixed voice here. I think he does at some point in the song, and I'll get into that in a little bit when he does. But I'm pretty sure that that was just falsetto and there's no mixed voice in it at this point.
Trying to find some peace of mind.
So that's interesting. I didn't pause it on time, but let's see if I can go back and show you again. Right there. So if you look, you can see that he kind of cocked up this side of his cheek. This is what we call manipulating embouchures. And I haven't really done a video too much on embouchures, so this is probably a good time for me to explain what embouchures are. Embouchure is a term that's used throughout multiple instruments. I don't play any other instruments that utilize embouchures, but if I'm not mistaken, I think clarinet, oboe, saxophone all use embouchure. Embouchure is basically lip shaping. And in singing, embouchures serve a very specific purpose in that the embouchure basically determines how the vowel is going to sound when it comes out of your mouth. Singing, most of the time, is predicated upon vowel usage. And the way that you use your vowels is going to have a major impact on how efficient your sound is, how healthy your sound is, and how clear your words are. So, as a simple example, if I use the letter O, and you look at the configuration of my mouth, when I say oh, my lips round, right? Well, if I tried to say oh, but I tried to make my lips go out wide, it doesn't sound the same. The vowel doesn't sound as pure anymore. Essentially, the configuration of everything in your mouth together creates your embouchure. And it's not, lip shaping is a huge aspect of it, but there are also elements like the position of the tongue as well that have to do with the embouchure that's created. Ultimately, when the sound comes from down here at the vocal folds, everything above it is what causes it to resonate. And ultimately, the final element of the sound coming out of your mouth is the shape of your lips and the position of the tongue. And if you, for example, raise the tongue up, if you go like this and raise your tongue up, then what happens is your sound is blocked. So if I try to talk like that,
I'm trying to talk like this,
it's almost indistinguishable, indecipherable, because the airway that the sound is also passing through is blocked. So if you look here, I'm not sure exactly what word he's singing, but if you take a look, his mouth is very closed, and he's got his teeth kind of showing here, and his bottom part of his jaw is raised up, and his mouth doesn't have a big space between. So what he's doing is he's cocking his cheek up here to give a little bit of extra space on this side of the mouth for the vowel to come out. And I don't know why you would do that, because it just requires more work than simply putting your mouth in the shape of the vowel that he's trying to sing. And this is a very common thing that happens. Even operatic singers, there's like this trope that baritones always cock up the right side of their mouth when they sing. And a few of them do, and it's something that they have to train and work out, because it just engages muscles that don't need to be engaged. I mean, if I'm saying the word how, for example, like, why would I need to go how? Like, that, why does that make sense? It's a habit that all of us have in some kind of capacity that it becomes exacerbated when we sing. And I'm not exactly sure where it comes from. And I'm not sure how people seem to get the impression that you sing better or more efficiently by making strange embouchures. There's a famous opera singer named Kathleen Battle, and she's kind of proven to be the exception of the exception to the rule. Her embouchures are very strange, and she makes beautiful sounds. So it's not that you can't make good sounds with weird embouchures, but most of the time you run into problems like your vowels not sounding like the vowels you're trying to create. And most of words are vowels. When you speak, vowels make the sound, and the consonants just sort of separate the syllables and give more clarity as to what word is actually being spoken, but the core of the sound comes from the vowels. So that's a little bit of an aside about embouchures, and there's going to be a few times throughout this video where I'm going to point this kind of thing out, but hopefully this sort of gives you an idea of what I'm looking for when I talk about embouchure. See there, he says, oh, but he's going, oh. And when I do that, I can feel tension welling up underneath my chin. But if I go, oh, then it's very different, because I have appropriate shaping of the lips and the vowel comes out clearly. Another thing that he's doing here is he's putting nasal resonance on it. So he's compensating for the lack of resonance that's created by the open space in the mouth by placing the resonance in his nose. So it comes out like, oh, like, oh, like that, as opposed to, oh, and it's not going to hurt you per se to stuff the sound in your nose, but it just doesn't create the same affect as when you sing with the right vowel. Your words just don't sound as clear. And it's a preference thing. I mean, some people like the nasal sound. Some people feel like they sing better with the nasal sound. My opinion as a voice teacher is that you can create sounds that are amazing without having to do unnatural things to make them happen. But I digress. Let's continue. So here you can pretty much clearly see the forehead tension that he's creating. His whole upper part of his face kind of tenses up like this when he does, that. It's just unnecessary. Now, here's the thing about Michael. Before you guys think I'm just totally bashing the dude, because I'm not. I love him. He's one of my favorite rock singers. He's one of those guys that I've classified in other videos as a freak of nature. He has been able to break all the rules. He smokes. He drinks. He does harsh vocals. He sings with all sorts of rough, raucous unrefined technique in terms of the bel canto or classical sense, but he's been able to maintain his voice pretty well. I mean, even videos from the past year or two from him singing live are still pretty decent. He keeps it together pretty well. I don't know. Someone made an interesting comment on one of my other videos not too long ago. Is, you know, maybe these people have figured out something that we haven't. And I'd like to quickly address that by saying that that's possible. But there are universal standards that are kind of applied to muscle usage. It's kind of like if someone told you that, you know, the best way to lift is by using your back and not your legs, and they use themselves doing it until they're 70 as an example of why that's the right way to be. Maybe they have discovered some super secret system of doing that that the rest of the world hasn't seen yet. And if that's the case, then that's something that merits a case study and a review on so that academia can better understand how that works. But as it stands now, he's just an exception. Some people's vocal tracks and the entire vocal mechanism can just take more abuse than others. And when that happens, those people are just very lucky and very fortunate, as far as we know. Now, if some new study comes down where they've scientifically and conclusively proven that this kind of stuff and his habits and his behaviors and his singing methods can be done sustainably if everyone just follows a specific method, and there's peer review on it, and it gets the type of study that the academic community tends to deem important and necessary for something to be considered truthful or scientific or factual, I will be behind it, absolutely. But for now, all I can do to describe how he does all these things and maintains his voice is that he's just a freak of nature and he's got vocal cords of steel. But as I always say to all my students who want to idolize these people, don't go into learning singing like you're the exception to the rule. It's better to set the fundamentally foundational sound habits and then discover the ways that you can stretch that in the future than to start off with the really bad habits and have years of doing bad things. And it's almost impossible to break those habits way down the line because your body's so used to doing things in a specifically destructive way. One thing that I will say about Michael that I really like consistently is that he's got a very good sense of legato. And what I mean by that is, generally speaking, he does this a few times, but generally speaking, he keeps the beginning of his phrase connected to the end of his phrase. Like, for example, he said, "Don't be afraid, hold my hand." Those are two separate phrases that you can pause between the two. And so he went from the beginning of the phrase and carried the singing sound all the way through it. And a common thing that I've mentioned before that you see with a lot of popular singers is that they will have this kind of thing where they take a breath every few seconds and it makes the sound be very kind of broken up. That's a very common thing that popular singers do, and it's usually just a sign of poor breath support, but it's also a sign of not knowing how to connect your words together. As I've said before, the idea is to make your singing and your speaking as closely related as possible, in that if you can efficiently speak out a sentence, there's no reason you shouldn't be able to sing out that sentence as well. There is a little bit more usage of air when you change pitches and when this whole mechanism's moving around more than when you speak. But generally speaking, if you can correlate the two to one another, then you're probably in pretty good shape and you shouldn't have to worry about not being able to maintain an entire phrase. Into the dark, there are eyelids closing. So I'm going to get kind of nitpicky here because I'm a voice teacher and that's what I do. So on the word in, and yes, voice teachers do listen for this stuff, believe it or not. On the word in, he actually didn't use a vowel. He went the shifting sand, the shifting sand. One of the best ways that quick tip you can use as a singer to make your singing more refined and more polished is don't cut off your vowels by closing on them. So instead of going in the shifting sands, he should have gone in the shifting sands. Unless there's some specific artistic reason you want to close the vowel there, which I mean, forgive me for saying this, but I highly doubt that he specifically was thinking of an artistic purpose of closing his N, closing the I on N. Generally, you want to let the vowel ring because the vowel is what makes the sound. You don't walk around saying, oh, I'm going in the house. I'm going in my car. You don't say that. I'm saying, I'm going in my house. What is inside of the basement? What's in the attic? You know, what's in the living room? You don't say what's in, you don't do that. So beat that point into a ground, nitpicky sort of thing. But if you're looking for little small things you can do to make your singing more refined, sing with vowels. Don't sing with consonants. Consonants weren't designed to be sung on. So one thing I want to point out, I always kind of talk about this with every singer that I review. He now in this video, I think this one's kind of old, he uses a lot of higher larynx positioning when he sings. But as he's gotten older, and it's interesting, this is kind of correlated along with him dropping a lot of the heavy stuff. He's been using more low larynx when he sings in his more recent stuff. But in this, he's definitely using a high laryngeal positioning. And I think that nasal resonance is a byproduct of him trying to project and having his larynx so high. As I've said before, when your larynx is high, your vocal tract as a whole is smaller. So when the vocal tract is smaller, there's not enough space for the sound to reverberate. And when there's less space for the sound to reverberate, you have to compensate for that lack of reverberation in some other way. And the nasal cavity is a really convenient place to slam all that resonance up into to where sound will be created. So that's very common for people to have really high laryngeal positioning and to put it through their nose. If you ever see a video from another like voice coach on YouTube, most of them are really bad, by the way. If you ever see anything where they're like, oh, sing with a high larynx, you need to be very skeptical, because singing with a high larynx, while you can create certain specific sounds with it, exclusively singing with a high larynx is going to cause a lot of force and extra pressure and a lot of extra weight to be put on your voice that shouldn't be. Generally, you want to have a larger vocal tract when you sing so that it takes some of the load off of all the mechanisms up here, and some of the load of projection can be done naturally by the extra space that you have. So in this case, he's singing with a high larynx. In his newer stuff, he doesn't really sing with high larynx. He positions things more in a more low state. And it makes me wonder if he hasn't had some kind of training or someone's told him like, hey, if you want to be more sustainable, you got to make some adjustments and make some adaptations. So if you notice there, another really subtle thing, when he went, he kind of went you saw his side of his lips go out like that when he said I. Again, that's kind of unnecessary, and it's indicative of some sort of habit he's gotten himself into. Like he has this notion that he has to move his lips in this way to make that sound happen. But the truth is that the more stationary your face is and the more relaxed the muscles in your face are, the more easily you're going to be able to navigate from one place to another. Now, I know I'm being really hard on him in this video, and I'm doing that because he's an exceptional singer. He has a great voice, and I don't need to go into the things of saying like, oh, well, he has great pitch acuity. Oh, well, he never misses a note. Oh, he's never flat. Oh, he's never sharp. I don't have to go into that stuff. So when I get a voice student that comes into my studio that already has these fundamentals down, I can really dig in deep and get into the nitpicky, detailed stuff. And these types of things that I'm talking about are the differences between taking a good singer and making him great, a great singer and making them excellent, and an excellent singer making them tip-top. It's those small adjustments and refinements, and that's what voice teachers should be for. A voice teacher should help you build fundamentals and then help you refine. Voice teachers should not be teaching you how to sound like your favorite singer. That's not what it should be. And if you see someone who's advocating, oh, you can sound like Mikael Akerfeldt if you want to, stay away. You're your only voice, and you should always remember that your voice is the best version of your voice in the world. and you should accept it for what it is and not try to make it into something that it isn't, a la someone else. That actually reminded me of a really good question that I was asked not too long ago watching that little instrumental section. Someone asked me, as a guitarist and a singer, how do you manage all the stuff of singing properly along with playing your instrument? And the answer to that question is, don't let your instrument interfere. Do as little as possible. Let it interfere as little as possible. One of the biggest things that I see that guitarists slash singers do is they hold their guitars too low. If your guitar is way down low and you're having to like bend over to play it, then that's causing the posture of your body to suffer as a result of your need to play the guitar. You might look like a dweeb, but if you're going to sing and play, the best way to do it, in my opinion, is to have your guitar up in a way more upright, higher, so that you don't have to change your body's position to be able to make sound, because you want that vertical alignment when you sing. You want the connection between the diaphragm and the lungs to the vocal folds and out the mouth to be as straight as possible. You don't want there to be interference in any way if possible. Another thing, a real quick tip to drummers, stay on tempo. And I know a lot of guys these days use clicks, and that helps things a lot. I don't know if they're using a click here or not, but it was clear that the tempo of the drumming was kind of up and down a little bit. Not much, but just a little bit. I mean, this guy's an incredible drummer. Opeth, I think, was his name. Forgive me if that's wrong, but he was an incredible drummer when he was with the band, and so I'm not knocking him at all. And tempos drift no matter what, but try to keep your tempo up for your singer's sake, because when you learn to sing a song, you kind of base your breath management upon the tempo. And if the drummer or whoever's accompanying you slows way down, well, then all of a sudden that coordination you've established on your ability to maintain your breath kind of goes all squirrely and goes out the window because, well, the tempo's not the same anymore. And yes, that makes a difference to singers. I hear a lot of complaints from instrumentalists that vocalists are just really whiny and they have all these problems and you always have to like work around them. But the reason is that we base so much of what we do upon a specific set of coordination. And if that coordination is off for whatever reason, we're not going to produce as good of sounds. It's just how the mechanism works. Speak to me now, and the world will crumble. So that's another one on the word crumble. He went crumble. So ideally, you would sing crumble, crumb, and you put the mb at the end of it. Crumble, not crumble, because the crumble with the extra little on it gives you a little bit more sound. It gives the vowel a little bit more space to move. And again, this is very nuanced and very subtle, but if you got with a voice teacher, or a good one anyway, they're going to point these things out to you. You don't want to close to your consonants too much. I think Michael has a tendency to do that a little bit much. And is it just me, or is one of the guitars out of tune? Like, it's been bugging me this whole time. I don't know. Maybe it's just me, but it sounds like the low E or something on one of the guitars is like a little sharp. I don't know. Open the door and the moon will fall. See, that was clearly an example of nasal resonance. When he got the child, that was definitely nasal resonance that he was using there. And so when you do the nasal resonance, the larynx is in a high position. So that's clearly an example of him using high resonance. Maybe in the future I'll go back and do a video of him singing more recently so I can show you the differences in the way that he's using his larynx then and now. One thing, though, to keep in mind is that the larynx doesn't even really get to the point to where it's like developed to even close to its final state of hardness until you're in your mid to late 20s. I'm 31, and I'm just now starting to get the feeling that I've got a lot of control over the usage of my larynx, and in so much as being able to make it create specific vocal colors and sounds. It's something that just takes time as you age, when the hardening of the larynx happens over time anyway. And I've discussed this in other videos, but essentially the cartilage hardens more as you get older. And once you hit your peak, which is probably going to be somewhere in your 30s to 35 until maybe you're 50, you're going to have that strength in your larynx that you won't have when you're younger. And that extra strength makes it to where lowering it, you're going to get a fuller sound. Oh, sleep my child. still bugging me. He should just go, oh, not, it's like Kermit the Frog. It's oh, not, oh. There's no reason not to just round your lips and make an O sound. So he does the ah thing again, the widening of the lips thing again. So that's definitely something that he's developed as a habit. Lots of times you don't even notice this stuff until someone points it out. My voice teacher, Dr. J. William Hobbins, he always would tell me that a voice teacher is not a voice teacher. A voice teacher is a trusted pair of ears. And that's always stuck with me. So that's what I try to be, is a trusted pair of ears. Oh, that forehead tension. Oh, it's no good. Okay, so that was a lot of instrumental stuff. I didn't realize that it was just a big instrumental section at the end, or I would have probably stopped it there. But either way, you guys got to see it, and it was awesome because they're just a great band. So, to summarize, Mikael Akerfeldt is an incredible singer. I love the guy. He's been one of my favorite rock singers since I was like in high school. I started listening during their Blackwater Park cycle. I love the guy. He's incredible. He's written some of my favorite music. He has excellent fundamental techniques. He's got good breath support. He's got good legato. He's got good phrasing. So all of these things are there. Like, he clearly has had someone help him with that, unless he's just some sort of prodigious vocalist who just understands those concepts without needing any kind of help. They're all there and they're all solid. His issues are more minute, and they're technical issues that have to be kind of panned out through redeveloping habits. I would say that if I had to guess as to why his voice is sustained as long as it has, is that he doesn't use a lot of push. He doesn't step outside of the range that his voice naturally wants to go to, and if he does, he goes into falsetto. Like, he doesn't try to force himself to sing higher notes than he can naturally. That will go a long way by itself. So he stays within his comfortable range, or tessitura, as the big word that I use in the John Arch video. He uses his own tessitura and he sticks to it, and it works really well for him. He has some lingering little issues with tension, and I think his onsets need some work. I also think that he needs to learn to shape his embouchures in a way that makes the vowels more clear and not close on them. He also, then I would have said that he needed to use more low larynx singing, but that's been adjusted and changed over time. And he doesn't really have that problem now so much. He still uses high larynx a little bit, but he definitely utilized the low larynx stuff more. So that's it. I hope you guys enjoyed this analysis. As you all know, I do have a Patreon. The link's going to be in the description. I'll pin a comment with it as well. I would love to see you subscribe and get involved, because there's lots of little perks that I give for being a Patreon subscriber. For example, being able to choose the analysis that I do for some Patreon levels. I also give voice lessons, but aside from that, I do give voice lessons privately, you know, separate from Patreon entirely. So if that's something that you're interested in, please feel free to hit me up, leave me a comment, or email me. I'll leave my email address in the description as well. And please like, share this video, subscribe. You guys know how it all works. I'm really trying hard to grow this channel, and your support is amazing, and I can't believe that we've gotten this far as it is. I'm so excited for what's coming in the future. I've got some neat stuff coming up I think you guys are really going to enjoy. And if you have any questions about anything, please feel free to leave a comment. I love reading you guys' comments and seeing what you have to say about things. And even if you don't fully agree with me on the things that I say, I still love hearing your perspectives and understanding, you know, where your concerns might be or what you may or may not understand. So please feel free to talk to me about this stuff. All right, so that's it for today. You guys, thank you for tuning in. I will see you all later. Take care.